Yeah, thank you very much for organizing this. And thank you all for being here. I'm Despoina, I'm from the University of York, and I'm a PhD student there, studying essentially the impact of storytelling, of archaeological storytelling for communicating archaeological research. So in order to do that, I have created the exact same story in three different forms for my project. One is a textual story, the other is an interactive and a VR video, an immersive one. The main point of it is essentially to be able to be created by the archaeologist. So no big funds, no huge training, just something quick and very effective to communicate your research to stakeholders or to local communities and staff. So bear that in mind, that I have created the media. So it's nothing like your presentation, for example. So yes, the knowledge that I'm trying to put out there is essentially everything about grave circle A, which is a cemetery in Greece. We'll see it in a minute. And especially the life and death of an individual with a code name MYC15. And other objective is to essentially explain to people that archaeologists don't have the answers, even if we are trying actually to be very specific. Everything is just an interpretation, especially for prehistory, which is my area of interest. And to offer an alternative story about the excavations in Mycenae. It's a very old excavation in this century. And bring back essentially the work of Sampatakou, who was the Greek archaeologist who was appointed to supervise Sliman during the excavation. So that's about it. So yes, my framework and tools that I have used for that project essentially is everything about, as I said, archaeological storytelling. It has a lot of bioarchaeology because a lot of information that I use to recreate the life and death of the individual is based on skeletal reports. Archaeogaming, because it has the interaction. Archaeology of personhood, public archaeology. And the tools are osteological reports. We have very recent osteological reports. The excavation is old, 19th century, but the skeletal remains were re-examined in 2007 because they were rediscovered during some renovation works at the National Archaeological Museum in Athens. This is a very long story for another time. Also, archaeological reports from the publications of Sliman and notes from Sampatakou's diary. Inscriptions on NRB tablets, Homeric epics, depictions, and some information from material culture. So yes, so that's Grave Circle A. So this is Greece, that's Peloponnese, Mycenae over there, and this essentially is the Mycenaean phase of the citadel. Grave Circle A is a cemetery right there. It wasn't fortified when it was constructed. I won't get into much detail. But essentially, the soft grave period is late Helladic, and the fortifications is here. So there is a big distance between the actual graves, which they are not Mycenaean, they are essentially the transitional period, to the Mycenaean era, where they were included in the whole citadel. We don't know why, but yeah, that's another story. So yeah, a closer look at Grave Circle A. There were six graves. Six graves. My case study is grave number 5. And as you most probably know, they were very richly furnished. Mycenaeans were, and then these people that they were buried there, they were like very extra. A lot of gold and the famous so-called Agamemnon's mask, which essentially was on the face of individual MYC15. Marked here with the letter TAF. So he had changed a lot of code names, which is part of the story, by the way. So yeah, so what I have created, a textual narrative, as I said, with footnotes, following Alexis Boutin's example she has done before. So it's the story and essentially footnotes underneath to explain which parts are fictive entirely, which parts are based on archaeological reports, which I am sure about, which I'm not, essentially. I'm trying to be very upfront. Then interactive narrative using Twine and the VR video. So it's not essentially, so there isn't an interaction in the video, it's a video. The people in my story is the individual, MYC15. I have made him, because I wanted to give this backstory of Slimon and Stamatakis and also to explain that archaeologists don't have the answers. So I have made him essentially very annoyed that people are messing up with his bones. And every time that someone looks up, is messing around with his bones, he remembers less and less and less, and he doesn't know his name. So the purpose of the whole thing is that we need to find his name. And he thinks that he's tough. He's confused, meaning tough, because he was a mark with the letter T. He essentially doesn't know his name, so it's very frustrating. Also Stamatakis, who was the Greek archaeologist, and Dr. Navpliotti, who got to re-examine the bones, as I said, in 2007. So that's the story about. And that's how the textual story looks like. So that's the bit of the story. And this whole thing is essentially the footnotes. Well, as you will see, some people loved it. So it's weird. The Twine now. So the Twine is an open source free tool to create interactive stories. It is more like, for me, it reminds me, I'm quite old, so it reminds me of these old books that they were like, okay, if you want the wolf, the bad wolf to eat Little Red Riding Hood, go to page 45. So it is quite like that. You have options, but they are rather limited. It's not like actual options. So you can jump back and forth. It essentially gives the opportunity to the user to skip parts that they aren't interested into. Exactly the same as the footnotes, I would say. So if you want, so there is like a text, you want to see why I'm saying that, you just go to the footnotes. In this situation, you either click on it or you don't. You skip it. And now I believe I should play, yes. Don't get scared if it is loud. That is how it looks like. And also I have tried to put very roughly, as you can see, the two different diaries, Stamatakis' diary and the diary with the astrological report, in the sense of clues. So the user can actually go through the clues and essentially have everything in their hands and make their own interpretations. Oh no, you're going to see it again. So, all right, and that is how the interface looks like the coding. So that's not visible to the user. So for the purpose of my research, it's fine because there was a learning curve, but it wasn't something disheartening. With the coding, there is a ready code that people can use actually, and a lot of things right now, after I created that, they are automated. So if you want to change colors, if you want to change backgrounds, photographs, put some motion, you can actually do it. It's not that bad. But you can see like the options. If someone clicks, there are options. It links like a web. It's a very nice tool. Now about the VR experience, as I said, I wanted it to be very mega and super wow, but I couldn't. because I mean, yeah, the purpose of it is to be able to be created by me. So initially I thought, okay, I will go for a blender to put everything in the blender, create like a beautiful lab, and people can click on things and they can find the clues, and then they can recreate the story themselves. But that would be like months. And yeah, I'm only a PhD student, so it wasn't very feasible. So I thought, okay, what's the next closest thing that I could do? I decided to go for a 360 film instead. So I recreated the environment exactly as I wanted in the Palo Hub that we have, like in the lab that we have in York. I laid my skeleton exactly as it was supposed to be. And I shoot a video in a loop. And then I made it into a VR. I made it essentially to be compatible to VR headsets. I use Vive and Premiere Pro essentially to edit it. So this is how the VR looks like. Imagine that essentially it is a 360 video, so the person is wearing like the Vive, and it begins pitch black. So it is like that.
Hey, you over there.
It's a plastic skeleton.
Yes, you can even look it to me. What is left of the room? Why are there? You are the only person in the room. The ladies are another check. Stop staring at the party and civic. You creep me out. I'm lying here on this cold examination table to be re-examined for the third time.
Yes. Oh no. Yeah, you click. Okay. Thank you. Sorry about that. So yeah, he's very annoyed. Essentially. Clearly. Okay. And then I had to create the experiment for it to test it on actual people and see what they think about it. So I have created the experiment like a pre-questionnaire, post-questionnaire, and an interview. I did the experiment in three countries, the UK, Malta, and Greece. And as I said, so I had three people treated with a pre-questionnaire. Then each one of them experienced each one of the media, one of them, then a post-questionnaire. And then they rotate to experience everything, and then we gathered all for a discussion. So essentially, I ended up with three data sets. I have both qualitative and quantitative data. I have a data set with the demographics, metadata notes to evaluate the impact of the stories, pre and post questionnaire to essentially understand, compare the previous knowledge with the new, and post questionnaire to see if I managed essentially to communicate what I wanted. The quantitative data, I created some charts with Excel. They look like this. Yeah, they look like this. And I made some observations. I am right now at this point. I'm trying to wrap up my discussion chapter. So essentially, the text is a very good medium for communicated knowledge. It's very easily accessible. It is not designed, and I have not designed and tested on people with disabilities, but generally it's accessible. Some people find that the amount of information is overwhelming. And despite that, people understood that archaeologists not always have the answers, the story that I was trying to communicate was not very effectively communicated. Twine seems to be like the perfect medium for this kind of situation. The interaction, people really love the interaction. So yes, essentially it ticks all of the boxes, as you can clearly see. And the VR, keeping in mind that only 1/4 of the people had experienced VR before, because it's quite important. It was again very overwhelming. It wasn't very easily accessible. Some people felt physically ill. It was very sad. And yes, but it was almost as good as Twine to communicate the things that I wanted. And with the qualitative data, I'm analyzing them using thematic analysis, and I am right now at the process of reviewing my themes. So some themes that I have now understand is that people seem to think that archaeology has changed and new methods are helping make new discoveries, that keeping archaeological records is important, everyone said that. Some people were worried about endangerment of artifacts. Some people felt sad or upset even because they couldn't know the individual's name or how he died. Everyone seems to think that we need to be respectful towards the dead. Some people felt sympathy for Sampatakis and for the archaeologists out there, which is very nice. And almost everyone said that a combination of media would have been amazing. And they expected interaction in the VR video, despite being told that there won't be any. So, yes, that's me. Thank you very much.